I'm a researcher in urban planning at the Royal Institute of Technology, KTH, in Stockholm. And I'm glad to be here in this course in green economics, because that's a topic that I find very interesting and relevant, although I do not have an economics background. I will approach this topic of the sharing economy from sort of more of a, say, environmental and societal perspective when it comes to the social and environmental benefits or potential benefits of it. Currently, I've been doing research on like a green or sustainable living, what that can be, who lives sustainable, why, how do we plan for sustainable living, and how does that relate to different societal groups, and so on. And that was my sort of focus, my PhD thesis. But since 2.5 or 2 years, I've been working on a project about sharing in sort of urban contexts, and what's called the sharing economy. And this is something I find sort of interesting, because in the field of urban planning, we are used to focusing on trying to sort of promote sustainable living through housing, more energy efficient housing, transportation, the large infrastructure systems of heating and so on. But in terms of more consumption, for instance, private consumption production is really topics that we don't touch, because that's often considered as beyond the reach of planning, and maybe also something that belongs to the whatever private sphere or something. But at the same time, we know that the ecological footprints that come from private consumption, that's the part that has been growing. I don't know, you are quite familiar, I know, with different sort of perspectives and critical theories in terms of sustainable development and so on, but maybe you've seen this, there was this recent study from WWF, Ecological Footprints, showing that, for instance, Sweden climbed in this the list of the worst countries from number 13 to 10, and the main reason for that was how private consumption, that private consumption has continued to grow. So maybe we are quite good in terms of energy efficiency in housing and infrastructure, but not when it comes to consumption. So, yes, when it comes to, how familiar are you with the concept of the sharing economy? Have you heard it before? Some of you have heard it, but not maybe all. Yeah. Okay. So this is a concept, and there are related concepts also, like the collaborative economy, collaborative consumption, peer-to-peer economy or peer economy. And these are slightly different concepts, but also there is some common denominators. And I would say that this is, if we now talk about the sharing economy, this is something that have been more and more come to be both practiced and discussed and debated the last, say, actually the last 3 years. So it's a, I mean, it's quite a sort of recent, it's not a new, for sure not a new phenomenon, it's been practiced for very long, but it's been increasingly spread and also sort of debated. So I will talk about the background to this and something, and also give examples from different fields of peer-to-peer sort of sharing practices, and then discuss whether do we see something, an emerging new form of economy, is actually the sharing economy challenging the sort of capitalist economy, or is it just being sort of a part of it? There are different sort of perspectives on this. And also some sort of questions where I would like to discuss with you regarding who benefits from this. So this you're probably familiar with, the sort of the critique in the late 90s about the sort of the corporate rule of the world. I mean, this was kind of the what came out in Naomi Klein's No Logo and the different protests at WTO meetings and so on. The fact that a few large corporations control much of the world's resources, and this kind of critique we've seen for many, many years, and I think it's also been taking sort of new shapes. I think this the focus on sort of shopping and consumption has also been sort of accelerated, because at least from an urban planning perspective, what we do is we generally plan for cities to be good sort of consumerist spaces very, very much, and this is, you can see a clear sort of fatigue of this also, you may say, that even nearly all spheres of life is becoming a commodity. This is an image from a project called The Story of Stuff. It is quite fun also, because there has been so much focus on when it comes to sustainable lifestyles and so on, with that you are supposed to live sustainably through buying ecological products or eco-labeled whatever, trips or tourism, etc. But focusing on actually, there is some kind of hierarchy here, where the first would be use what you have, actually, not only consume eco products. Borrow, swap, thrift, make, then buy. So I think this kind of critique towards kind of the consumerist society is something that we've seen quite a lot these last years. And in 2000, there's a book called What's Mine is Yours, and the subtitle is The Rise of Collaborative Consumption, written by Rachel Botsman and Lou Rogers, and they were made the first ones to use the concept of collaborative consumption. They wrote this in 2011, but in 2012, this is from an article by Botsman, they've been doing then sort of empirical sort of research about sharing practices and seeing what is actually what this is and why it has appeared and spread. And what Botsman argues is that what she calls a collaborative consumption, which is actually then part of the sharing economy, is sort of arising or growing now because of these four sort of factors that sort of drivers of the expansion of peer-to-peer sharing. And what she's arguing is what we're seeing now is kind of old market behaviors like bartering, swapping, giving, using secondhand, etc., that we have traditionally been practicing in lots of societies all over the world, but that is being kind of reinvented with contemporary digital technologies. It's being sort of facilitated by real-time technologies. It's much easier to match needs with wants today with through the internet and different digital tools like GPS. And I think one example of this is, say, Airbnb, in a sense. Yes, someone you know. But this is a platform, an internet platform where you can basically you can rent apartments or houses or bit or parts of rooms or so. And you can rent out and you can rent. And this has been, this kind of renting out when you're away, that has been practiced for years. But a platform like Airbnb has kind of facilitated this and made it go from a niche, a small practice, to really being applied in a very sort of by wider groups of people. Now Airbnb has gone from actually they are serving people with more sort of nights than the big, some of the big hotels like Sheraton, Marriott, etc. So they're actually being now challenging some of the big hotel corporations, although it's individual sort of homeowners or
whatever.
Yes, that's true. It's from the beginning, the idea with Airbnb was that it should be idle space or space that you didn't use, you're supposed to rent out. But then it's been so successful that actually many hostels, like you say, use it. So they use it as a site for advertising. And then it also has become a very, we'll return to Airbnb, because that is becoming like a global corporation in itself. It's become huge, really. And the question is whether that has any or environmental sort of benefits or not. But anyhow, as an example, you can see that digital technologies and the maps, now it's very easy, you can see. I mean, through before, if you're supposed to rent an apartment, you'd have a small listing in a paper. You wouldn't know who the person you're renting from, who he or she is. How do I know it's the transaction will go well? What if it's really, whatever, smelly, the apartment? But through a site like these, like Airbnb and many others, you can get very much detailed information, photos, Google View street maps, reviews from other users, the profile of the person, etc. So you can make use of so much more information today. So that's one key thing. And then it's also sort of being spread in a context where there's also a sort of a desire for creating community or for not only being the anonymous buyer and seller, but to sort of building sort of identities and community. And there's also a context of environmental concerns in a sense that the situation today many people are very aware of the sort of environmental situation and climate change, and see that the levels of consumption in at least in the northern hemisphere are too high. And the fourth thing is that this is also taken off since the economic recession and the crisis in 2008. That's the fact that many people have had less incomes and have been more or less forced to find practices of sharing things or making use of assets that they didn't think you could maybe make use of, like tools or an extra whatever bed, etc. in your home. So in that sense, the sharing economy is not new, but it's being practiced in a new context and being facilitated by new forms of technology. So the first sort of example, which is maybe the most sort of well known, is peer-to-peer sharing of goods. So this is the book that I was talking about. Basically that you rent, swap, or give, or whatever, share things. I mean, it could be tools, it could be different sort of appliances, clothing, toys, and this is one such example that I've been doing empirical studies of, called Street Bank. It started in the UK some years ago, and basically you get the idea from this little drawing here that there are lots of stuff in homes, in many homes that are, and often they are not used all the time. A ladder, for instance, is used maybe 3 hours in its entire lifetime. And if it would be easier for people to actually swap and borrow things, or actually this is the street bank, is no, here's no money involved, so this is giving and lending. Okay, so this is not bartering actually. That's the idea. So in this type of, there's also this, you have this site, you can register, you have a profile, and you can say like, I have these things, for instance, I have a power drill, I have a wetsuit, I have a pasta machine, whatever, sewing machine, etc. And these are things that I could be okay with to lend to my neighbors. So people do this, and then you can search for things. You can also, request things, like, for instance, some of the examples that we came across when we were in London was that a woman had, for instance, she had requested a wetsuit. She was going to surf and she wasn't sure whether this would be, you know, a one time thing, so she didn't want to buy a wetsuit. And within 24 hours, she got three people in her neighborhood saying that you could borrow a wetsuit from me in the right and so this is driven very much by a will to reduce sort of the private consumption, but also it's very much a social thing, that people that are interested in getting to know and whatever, socializing with their neighbors. And it's been, actually it's spread all over the UK, and it's been quite a success actually. And it's an open platform, so anybody could sort of just log onto it, and you could take it to other countries as well. I don't know, one year ago, I registered to see whether it's been used in Sweden, and it was not so much used at that time. I had like two people in a radius of 3 kilometers or something. So you can use it. It works well both for sort of urban conditions, where then you can decide in what kind of radius you want to search for things or lend things. So if you live in whatever more countryside, you could have a larger distance. So that's sort of one such example. So they're both these kind of non-profit or with there's no money involved. And there are also those that actually, examples, when we talk about the sharing economy, you also include things like basically renting, and that's been going on for a long time, renting like party clothes, for instance, or renting skis and things like that. But it's particularly this peer-to-peer, in the sense where individual citizens are being connected to each other, where they can borrow and lend or whatever, swap things, that has is maybe now being sort of increasingly sort of facilitated. And some other examples of this are like clothing libraries, you've heard of. I heard there's one in Uppsala. Have you been there? Yeah. No? Yeah. There is one in Gothenburg, there is one in Malmö, there is one in Gävle, I think, there's one in Umeå, for instance. And they work, there used to be one in Stockholm, I think it closed actually. But they can be organized in different ways. But the one in I've done research on one in Malmö, and that works in this way, that you are it's free, anybody can come and borrow clothes. You can use them for 3 weeks, you return them clean and in good shape. If something is broken, you need to sort of pay that or give something in return. So it doesn't cost anything, it's free, but once you have used it 3 times, or you have been wearing clothes 3 times, you are asked to, or you need to contribute to the klädotek. You need to work there, at least not often. often, but maybe some hours each month or every second month or so on. So, because it of course takes time to manage this and to take care of the clothes and to taking new clothes, and they also have a digital site, so you can actually, or they're at least working on this digital site, or they're, it's up, I'm not really sure yet, but anyhow, of course there's a lot of work in managing this. So how do you, if you can, if there is no money involved, how do you get it to function? So that's one way. And then there are other clothing libraries where you pay a small fee, or, and there is also one where you actually pay quite a big fee. I mean, some of these, they really range from the very sort of, like I said, non-profit or maybe quite radical sort of examples that you, I mean, this, the one in Malmö, for instance, it's called Gemensam Garderob. It's, there is a kind of subtitle, the common wardrobe. Or so the idea is basically, I mean, in the long run, maybe you wouldn't, we all would need so much or very little actually private clothing. We could have a common wardrobe. And there are some of the ones that are involved in this try also to live almost without money. But then there are all those on the sort of more commercial side. There's one in central Stockholm that rather sort of where you're, it's also a clothing library, but then you pay quite a big sort of fee, and it's kind of designer clothes, new designer clothes, and it's more sort of marketed towards whatever women in their 40s or so on that don't maybe want to buy all these things, or they want to be sort of be updated clothes-wise, but not necessarily having the resources to resources or interest in buying everything. So you see, they operate on a more strictly sort of commercial level. Yeah, and there are these two libraries. They're spread in many cities. And they can also function on sometimes more commercial, sometimes more sort of non-profit or on a voluntary basis. There is, again, I've been doing most of my empirical work in Malmö. There is one in Malmö called Toolpool, and that is an ordinary, or maybe not so ordinary, but say in the what do you call it? Järnhandel, a hardware store. So it's a hardware, it's a manager of a hardware store that is simply interested in high quality products, and that people don't buy things that break and sort of over consume non-qualitative products. So he wanted them to basically lend people good tools. So now he's developed this tool bank, basically, where anybody can use, come in and use these tools. You can book on the internet also, and it's lots of different types of tools, and it's for free. But he's kind of, why he's doing it is of course because he believes in it, but also because he gets customers, people like coming to his hardware store, and they often buy other things. And there are some that are driven by or managed by the municipality. I think this one in there is one in Oakland and in Vancouver, and I think many of them are, I mean, non-profit also. There is a part called the Garaget in Malmö where you can also, on your library card, where you usually borrow books, you can also borrow tools. So then it's kind of funded by the municipality. Yeah, and another field where this is being sort of practiced quite a lot of this kind of peer-to-peer sharing is transport. Obviously, most of you know carpools, different forms of carpools, which is something that have grown, and bike sharing, something we see in many cities today. And different forms of carpooling have sort of appeared. I mean, there are these... Huh, I thought I got them in English. Okay, the most of the other ones are in English, but this is Swedish. So you have the commercial carpool, say like Sunfleet is, I think, one of the biggest in Sweden. So you have your you have a membership there, you pay to them, they own the cars. So that's one form. But then you have the peer-to-peer platforms, which is different. Then you have, then it's actually connecting individual car owners with car users. So then it's not the company owning the cars. And this is, I think, also very much what the digital technologies have been sort of facilitating, because then there are these applications where you could, like, basically you can, I mean, in Spain, I've studied this, it's called Social Car there. You could go into the site or the app and see, okay, I live here, I want to a car on Thursday. And then you can see, aha, in my neighborhood there are four different cars that can be used. And they are then owned by whatever, your neighbors, or maybe people you don't know. So in that sense, it's it becomes, yeah, actually this creates kind of micro entrepreneurs, you can say, or people that are not, I mean, that's not their main income to be, they're not the car rental company, but they happen to have assets that they can make a little bit of money of. So what you can see appearing now from the sharing economy are people that do different type of renting, swapping, etc. Maybe you have a small space that you lent out on Airbnb, you have a car, you have tools that go into a tool pool, you have this, I didn't bring that example, there's something called Eat With, where you arrange dinners in your home. So lots of different things, actually, which is interesting in many ways, because it's not, like I said, it's not companies. It's rather a form of sort of, you're becoming a micro-entrepreneur, and some are arguing that these are maybe sometimes unwilling micro-entrepreneurs, where there's also a question of whether this is taxed or not, etc. And this is a little bit different in different countries also. But in the field of transportation, then there's also what's developed. Okay, it's carpooling and peer-to-peer cars. Probably you heard of Uber. So they've expanded quite a lot in they're all over the not the all of the world, but in many many cities. Now they started in San Francisco. Since 1.5 years, they're in Stockholm and in Gothenburg. And they are, I think, one of the together with Airbnb. Uber, or one of the big corporations in the sharing economy, and maybe one of them that have been very much criticized also for, in a sense, appropriating or using the language of sharing, but it's actually quite a lot of just a different form of taxi. But they've recently launched a samåkningstjänst. What's that? Ride sharing, I think it's called. Ride sharing. So they're not only actually, they started as a form of taxi or where you rent a chauffeur basically. So it's not a taxi with a taxameter where you can see what it costs, but it's a fixed price. But now they're doing ride sharing as well, and arguing that they are very much a social, wanting to build communities, etc. Also, and this BlaBlaCar car is also an interesting phenomenon. It's also become huge in Europe. There, I think, in nearly all European countries now, also in Russia. So basically, this is also a form of car sharing. So then it's not carpooling, but actually people that are going from one spot to another spot say that this is where I'm going, and then you can take along other passengers, and then you share the cost of fuel, which for many places and countries where there is not good public transport, this has become very popular. And I think in many countries, maybe in the northern European countries, I think there has been historically there's been a lot of ride sharing because there's quite a high level of trust amongst people. But I think in many other countries this is a sort of new phenomenon to do this. And that has also been growing in the US because quite a lot of as a result of the economic crisis, that people have been, in a sense, forced to find ways of traveling cheaper. Yes. Yeah, so, and sharing of space is another, a third sort of field where this is, where we can see this today. Like I mentioned, Airbnb, there's also this couch surfing, which is maybe a not so commercial form of sleeping at other people's homes. Here again, it's very important this the reputation you get. I think this is common for many of these platforms, that if you're a good host on couch surfing, for instance, if you get sort of good reviews, you are also, it's much easier for you to find homes elsewhere. So, like, there's this Rachel Botsman, again, who's been working in this collaborative consumption, is arguing that the new currency in the sharing economy is very much trust. Rather that, I mean, that you need to be somebody that acts properly and that delivers things on time and is good to collaborate with, rather than rather than credit being the traditional form of currency. And then there are different forms of, like, open repair studios, like the repair workshops. There's this one again, an example from Malmö called Cykelköket. This is also a concept that exists in many cities. It was originally, first one was in Los Angeles, called Los Angeles Bicycle Kitchen. And the idea here is basically that you share a space for working on your bike. And you do it, there's a collaborative idea in this that you help each other in fixing your bikes. It's a kind of a DIY workshop, so you work on your own bike, but you help other people. And there are tools and lots of different tools available, and also parts from old bikes. So you can also build the bikes from scratch, basically, because people, in this case in Malmö, lots of housing corporations, they get lots of leftover bikes. People move and they don't sometimes care to bring their old bikes, so they get this. So there are old bikes and there are bike parts that you can use, and it's become this in Malmö has become a very successful, actually also social meeting place. It's actually fantastic to be there. It's lots of people from lots of different backgrounds, different ages that come there. Some come there often to just hang out or help other people. It's and there is basically this sort of culture of collaborating and fixing things yourself, rather than just, of course you could then pay for this service, but there is something, an interest in doing these things yourself or doing it together. So that's a form of, you could say, space sharing, although it's also sharing of tools and knowledge. So
what makes it free? Does community pay for the places?
Yeah, they're actually different forms. In this case, in Malmö, again, it's the municipality. The municipality in Malmö is quite active in these practices, so they pay the rent. This, in the summer, it's outside. Otherwise, it's located in a space called Stapeln, where they have a quite big space. And then the municipality also pays for a half-time employee. And then there are lots of sort of volunteers or people. Also, we've also met and interviewed people that are new to Sweden, that are not formally allowed to work, but they work there or informally work there. But then the one in Gothenburg, for instance, Cykelköket in Gothenburg, they don't have any public funding, so they're basically managing on their own and with volunteers that work there, and they have a very, very, very small space. So, and I think I've heard that there's one starting up in Stockholm also. Sorry?
In Uppsala,
I did that. Yeah.
In Ungdomshuset.
Yeah, and there's also this another example that I haven't done. I've just read about it. I haven't done any empirical sort of work on it. It's like land share. So you can see the idea here. Basically, you connect people that have space or land to share with people that are interested in growing, producing land, and then they make a deal with that I get whatever half of the carrots that you have grown in my garden. But it's quite interesting way of thinking about resources. This example where you kind of blur or change what's considered as private. This is my whatever private space and what's somebody else's. Here you have people let in other people in their front or backyard. This is also in the UK. Another example that I have sort of followed now for 2 years is called Allmänna kontoret, which is basically translates into the public office. And it's an experiment, you could say, to establish an open workspace for anybody to use. It's like an extension basically of the library, the idea of the library, but all with good sort of spaces and facilities for freelancers and people working in different ways, maybe don't know, could be people unemployed or retired, whatever, people that need a proper space to sit and work. Because actually, even in the human rights, it's said that people should have a proper work, a place to work, not only the work as such, but actually a physical, good working place with whatever, colleagues and facilities. And in sort of the contemporary sort of project-based economy, lots of people, as you probably know, don't have a fixed sort of employment. Lots of people work on different projects, they're freelancers, or they don't have a workplace. Often cafes and libraries are filled with people that are actually working, but what they're arguing in the group that have started Allmänna kontoret is that this should actually also be a function, a sort of service from that just like we have public libraries and public swimming halls, there should be public offices, because this is an important sort of function in society. And now they are collaborating with a library in one of the northern suburbs in Stockholm to establish this. This was there there was a test period in the city, or the Museum of Architecture. That's where the picture is from. Again, they are thinking of developing this also like an open source concept. So basically anybody could set up a public office in Hudiksvall or a small town or whatever in the countryside, but based on certain idea of openness and how it could be managed, etc. But the idea is to spread this kind of concept.
Can I make a remark on that?
Oh, sorry.
Can I make a remark?
Yeah, sure.
There's a new phenomenon that's called the guerrilla office.
Guerrilla office, huh?
It's for small computer companies that they gather, sit at some bar or something, that they announce their meetings, and then they go there and just sit at some hotel bar.
Okay, but then they're appropriating space to do this, then, in a sense.
They bring those computers like that and sit together.
Okay.
But there are apparently also cafes that only that just pretend to be cafes because you pay for the minute that
you're
right.
There. Right, there are those also.
And then coffee and cake is for free.
Yeah. Those cafeteria, they started by a Russian entrepreneur, and he insisted it's not a cafe, it's a co-working space.
Yes.
So he rents like space for people to co-work.
Yeah, so that the concept of co-working spaces is really something that has spread, I think, also, and it can take different forms. It could be like this. I think is Almena Kontoret is a form of co-working space, but it's open and free. But there are others that operate much more on a commercial basis that are, and some that are quite actually expensive to use. But the idea with many co-working spaces is that you also not only just go there with your laptop and work and then you leave, but many of them have ideas. I don't know the ones you are thinking of. Yeah, social space. Maybe you share common whatever workshops or meeting rooms, and you organize events together. Events that even if you're working in different fields, you all have whatever an interest in, say, developing your internet site or something like this.
The main idea of the Russian guy who first started the part-time, like paper-time cafes, he was like, the people don't come and just do their thing, but they come and meet other people and get to do things together. So people with ideas can find like other people to get like to work together on their ideas.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not very successful yet. Most people just come and do their own things.
Yeah. So that can work in many different ways. There's also this, in relation to your comment, there's also something called Hoffice, I don't know if you heard that, which is actually then home office, and that's basically it's organized on via Facebook. So you organize like a home office. So I would open my home, say Thursday to Thursday that week for X number of people to come work in my home. Yeah.
Is it divided on different branches of work?
No, actually, I don't know. I've never actually interviewed or used this Hoffice. I just heard about it. But it's also you need to get invited. So it's you're a friend of a friend or a friend or something in this Hoffice. But it's not. I don't think it's organized in different branches. The idea is also that you could work and sit together with other people. Okay, so that's sharing a space, and then it's also the field of sort of peer-to-peer production of hardware. I mean, peer-to-peer software is very well known. It's been around for many years. Like you probably know the software Linux, for instance, one of the more well-known examples, or Wikipedia is also a good example of a sort of peer-to-peer knowledge source. It's developed by everyone or lots of people, and it's open for other people to use. It's not Wikipedia is not owned by any private owner, etc. But now this kind of the peer-to-peer production that's been in very much sort of practiced in software and knowledge production is also coming to hardware, and in terms of these fab labs, for instance, that are you can find in many places around the world. And I've been doing research in Barcelona, and I think it's interesting that the city of Barcelona, they have as their vision to become a fab city. That the fab lab, which is a production, it's an open workshop actually, where you often have different forms of digital. Or tools for digital fabrication, also sometimes for more like low-tech fabrication, like big sewing machines or things like this. But that they have the idea that this is like the library of the future, basically, that it's a community center. You can come there and repair or produce things. I don't know how it will go, but now they have, I think, 5 fab labs in Barcelona, and 2 of them are managed by the municipality. But the idea is there should be one in every district. And I don't know if we have time, but this open source sort of ecology, I know we skipped, but you can give you this PowerPoint, and you can look if if you're interested in this TED talk, it's only like 5 or 7 minutes, but it's with this, it's describing this open source ecology project, which is quite interesting. It's an example of peer-to-peer hardware focused on producing the machines that are necessary for a civilization. It's very sort of, has very much of the of utopian sort of thoughts in it, because much of the fab labs are, the, what is being produced in fab labs are often quite, maybe it's too mean to say useless, but lots of whatever, prototypes and things that are not really, I mean, it's more like it's fun that you can construct, when I've been at a fab lab, to construct like a bracelet from plastic in a 3D printer, but it's maybe doesn't have so much environmental benefit. Although there is, I mean, there's some potential here also to use, of course, fab labs to produce furniture, beehives, things like that. But this project is very much into producing sort of, machines needed for survival. Yes, so here's this quote from this Jakubowski. He was one of the sort of founders of this open source ecology. So he's basically describing, the idea is to develop these open source drawings and open source production of this brick pressing machine, windmill, oven, multi-purpose tractor, etc. Using local material, actually. So his vision or his idea is basically, you can see here, much as Wikipedia sought to democratize knowledge and the open source software movement sought to democratize computing, open source ecology seeks to democratize human well-being and industrial tools that help to create it. So, he's basically arguing that now it's the knowledge and the tools for producing the machines, like whatever, tractors and cars, etc. It's often in the hand of big corporations, and it costs a lot if you want to repair something. I mean, like with whatever new iPhones, you cannot, it's very difficult to repair them yourself. You cannot even remove the battery that you, before you could often, I mean, in older computers, you could pull them together or apart and then repair or hack them or do different things. But now it's often, products are often made to break in some years, and very difficult to actually repair. So his idea is to make this modular, sort of very robust machines. And he's arguing that much as the garage hackers fuel the computing boom, the garage manufacturing revolution, and this is what his word for, like, the makers movement, is beginning to enable manufacture of tools that was once the domain of a few corporations, accessible to everyday people. This is exactly the kind of creative destruction that economist Joseph Schumpeter would have been proud of. So, I think that is, it's an interesting idea. We'll see how it develops the whole field of peer-to-peer hardware. But I think that this, it's exciting, I think. It's very an exciting development when you think about how, I mean, access to information today has been so widely spread. What if actually access to production of things that we need would be as accessible and as democratic? And then the fifth field, which I should say that this is the field that I know the least of, but it's peer-to-peer finance, and you probably heard of Bitcoin. It's one example of a peer-to-peer currency. There are lots of different ones. There's peer-to-peer currencies. Bitcoin is only one of them. There's this Peercoin, for instance, and others. And I just mentioned this because this is also, I think, something that will transform the economy in the future. Different forms of alternative currencies, and also peer-to-peer concerns. Currencies. People that I know that are working in this field are saying that Bitcoin, there's lots of problems with Bitcoin, and it will probably not be so spread, but it's the beginning of something. There will be new forms of this that will likely be be spread. But it's interesting that, that many of these alternative currencies are actually being now also not only used for trading things on the internet, but like in, I was at this sharing whatever convent, and then there are these universities in the Netherlands. They are, you can pay your university fee, for instance, in Bitcoin now. It's interesting. And different forms of peer-to-peer finance, crowdsourcing, etc. So, what? How can we understand this? This, now I've gone through lots of different sort of examples, so I'll try to say a few analytical words about this, and then come into the questions. But so, what you can see is that in some of these examples, they are very much, I mean, they are basically incorporated in the market economy. I mean, Airbnb would be placed here, actually. Both the platform inventors and the users, I mean, they make profit. It's not a conflict with the market economy. While some are actually, say, this Kladoteket in Malmö or the open source ecology project, it's something actually there is a will to establish another economy that is not based on profit, that is not based on private ownership. You wanted to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask how long you planned this presentation to be, because if it would go another hour, I would suggest maybe a break now.
Yeah. No, not another hour. But we could. What we could do is actually we could take a break now. We'll use until 4, but if we take break until 3:20.
I don't. It would be just 5 minutes.
Oh yeah, no, but okay. But 3:15, and then I could continue, and then we end with the last 25 minutes or something with a discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, so 3:15, a short break. Yeah, we need some air. Different forms where some are. There is to varying degree interest in sort of challenging the mainstream sort of economy. And there are also those that exist, like I think the example of Street Bank that I took. Yes, that is, you don't have any money involved, but it's actually more of a complement to the whatever market economy. The idea is not to replace the market in any sense, but rather as something that exists beside it. So there you can find lots of different perspectives here. But if we then take on this side, sort of sharing and peer-to-peer practices that do have sort of an idea about another sort of economy, one way to understand this is what Jochai Benkler has called commons-based peer production. And Jochai Benkler is a professor of law at Yale University, and he's been looking at the commons-based peer production in the software or in the software production in the field of knowledge production. But he argues that this is possibly applicable also to production in the physical world, not only on the internet. So what he then, you can think of the example of Wikipedia, for instance. So basically, commons-based peer production is based on contributions rather than the notion of equivalent exchange. I mean, the market economy is based on I give you something and in return I get something else. It can be, we do it in money, or it can be in other forms of products. But rather than, like, say Wikipedia is based on people that have knowledge in the subject, they contribute to Wikipedia. Those that have maybe more interest in knowledge do it more, whilst others maybe don't do it at all. And two, it's motivated not by profit, but to fulfill needs, innovate, or just the social desire to work together. So that, I think, applies to Wikipedia as well. Or different forms, I mean, Linux you could think of, or other such examples. Conducted as peers in non-hierarchical networks, sometimes requiring reciprocal contributions and sometimes not. So there, in contrast to, say, a whatever traditional company or a state-managed institution where you have the boss actually saying to the workers, you need to do this and this, this is your job. This is, say, Wikipedia, people contribute, they work together in a more horizontal way. And again, the case of Wikipedia, you're not users, you don't have to contribute to use, but there are other systems, peer-to-peer systems, where in order to get access to the resource, you need also to contribute. Like the case of Kleroteket, I think this applies to as well. You cannot only just borrow clothes, at some point you also need to contribute. And the fourth, that is based on an ethic of sharing and common ownership rather than competition and private property. So that's also a key thing. And these together, these sort of aspects are different from, say, traditional sort of capitalist production, which is very much centered around profit, equivalent exchange, and property, the protection of private property. So what Benkler is arguing is that in certain fields, we are actually seeing a mode of production which is not capitalist, which is not socialist, but something else. So he argues that this third mode of production. I will skip to... Yeah, this is basically what he's saying. He's calling it commons-based peer production and arguing that this is not a mix of socialism and capitalism, but something actually different. But back to this then. So I think the parts of the sharing economy actually they are based on an idea of commons-based peer production, although maybe they don't say it themselves or are aware of it, but like Kleroteket. So here is, this is I've taken from another researcher. He's then trying to explain the sharing economy and seeing what that could mean in the future then. If we go from a focus on credit to reputation, this is what I was talking about before with trust, from advertising, that companies are working with advertising, to actually companies or whatever movements working with establishing community. And this is interesting, I think, because both the big platforms like Airbnb, they're not saying that they're making advertising, they're also building community. So they're using this kind of language. And not a focus on individual ownership, but rather on access to something. So that's where there's a difference. So this is then what... from an international perspective, the sharing economy, that maybe when it started up and when the first people started to talk about peer-to-peer sharing economy, was a very much a marginal thing, and it was often associated with maybe dreams and ideas about another economy, but now it's gone very big and mainstream. And in 2011, Time magazine was arguing that collaborative consumption is one of the top 10 ideas that will change the world. Recently, PricewaterhouseCoopers argued that in Sweden only, it is assumed to, or predicted to grow quite a lot in terms of, also in the formal economy. There is one report that I read that arguing that in the US economy, one-sixth of the economy is actually what could be described as sharing economy. So it's actually it's beginning to be a considerable part of the economy. But it's also what you can get in these figures, it's only the commercial ones, basically, or the ones involved with money. But if you'd include also the non-monetary forms, then it's difficult to know calculate their value, but it's probably larger. So if you read, magazines like The Economist, lots of articles about the sharing economy. So it's something that also big businesses are starting to care about, both for maybe for good and bad. So what can be said then? I more or less said this. So it's not for sure. It's not new, but it's something that is being facilitated by ICT, and I think you can also see it in other, say in the field, like I was talking about software and knowledge production, I think there has been now for years, young people have been getting used to not only being passive consumers of things, of news or TV programs, but actually being part of producing news and stories. And I mean, through Facebook and Twitter and blogs, etc., that there is a more active sort of public sphere rather than just passive consumers. And that is now also being expanded, not from internet to the physical world as well. There's one study that argues that has seen that sort of online sharing and the practices of sharing information, files, things on internet is also leading to and facilitate kind of offline sharing. So that this, I mean, the fact that now young people, you stream music, for instance, you don't own CDs anymore, or that's also some being affecting other sort of domains where you don't necessarily see it as necessary to own things. You rather maybe build your identity through, you know, your playlist or through things that you know, rather than things you own. And so this is then what Winkler argues, and you could see whether that's the case or whether commons-based peer production is just something that exists next to, or maybe even facilitates the market economy. And to end with, I think there are lots of, I think, potentials and interesting examples within what I've described as the sharing economy, but there are also quite a lot of questions and sort of challenges here. Firstly, to say that there is a risk of the creation of kind of informal economies, where there is also when there is this more of sort of peer-to-peer production of things, there is also a risk of that you dismantle the public welfare systems and the taxation and the welfare based on taxation, because I mean, at least in a country like Sweden, it's the whole welfare system is based on people pay a lot of taxes, and if they would get less income and pay less taxes, what would happen to the welfare system? So do we need to think about other, maybe if people then maybe own a little bit less, they maybe don't have so much in the future, such high private incomes, but they have other things. Do we need to then contribute to the public system in other ways? That could be something to think of or question. There are those that argue that we don't necessarily need to think that we should contribute to the public system through tax, but you could contribute through work or other forms. And also I should say that some of these practices, like I mentioned this Eat With, for instance, which is this micro organized dinners at your home, that is in Spain, that's totally legal, you can do it, you earn a little bit of money for it. But in Sweden, that would be that would be illegal, actually. You're not allowed to have arranged dinners with strangers in your home and getting paid for it. Then you need to file as a restaurant, and then you need to have certain facilities, etc. So this is also applies, it's different. Whilst that I know in England, when they having this kind of micro dinners, then it's arranged in a way that you do it, but then you don't have a prize for the dinner, but you have people, you said you can donate, you have donations. So that's a way to getting around it. But then what means, I mean, then there's this kind of, it becomes like a grey economy. And also the lack of maybe control. What about, I mean, Airbnb, Uber, Eat With, how do you know that it's good quality? How do you know that you don't get food poisoning, for instance, and all of these things that they have been developed through public control. So that's a question. At the same time, I didn't put that up here, but that, I mean, there's the potential of democratizing, I mean, the democratization of resources, that not, I mean, that it's not only then states or big companies that control sort of resources and money, but actually that ordinary, whatever, citizens can become more active in using resources and swapping and sharing things. So there is this democratization potential, but it's not only necessarily, it's not all a positive story. And you have this, that it also, some of them that's maybe started as a small sort of niche practices, like I said, have become very big now, being funded by Google. So they're becoming like transnational corporations. And also, some of these examples I described have, I think, a clear environmental sort of benefit, but some, we don't know. I mean, like with Airbnb, it's also made traveling less expensive, so maybe then people travel even more. Is that good necessarily? Yeah, and also the fact, what about people, I mean, the peer-to-peer economy is very much based on, like I said before, on contribute, that you can kind of, you can do something, that you work, I mean, that you have something to contribute with. But what about the groups and people, I mean, when we're sick and old, etc., how do we arrange systems so that everybody, it's not reliant on sort of active citizens? These are some of the questions that I think is sort of relevant to discuss, but feel free to comment or ask other questions. So, do you say? Yeah?
I had a question, a few slides, yeah, when you talked about how now this is evaluated and like, kind of aggregated by big companies or the state, the government, basically. Now they try to account for what is happening there, and it's like already put the numbers again and try to be represented by prices. And I was really wondering, like, why would you do that now? This is I mean, the whole idea is not to have like numbers and just to let people interact. Why would you have to count this into the economy,
right,
again? What do you think? Why are they doing this?
Yeah, I think from there is a big sort of interest in the sharing economy also from I mean both governments and private companies, because you can see that you can actually do business out of this.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, like many of these sharing platforms have gone, I mean, there are huge investments in them and so on. So I think also traditional companies, say, I know, like General Motors, they have, I mean, producing cars. Now General Motors bought Zipcar, which Zipcar was the first peer-to-peer car lending service. So that was very sort of grassroots, started by sort of more or less ordinary citizens interested in environmental issues, and then become so spread in the US, so GM actually thought it was a threat to their sort of core concern, which is cars. So they bought it, and then they basically turned it into a car rental company. So I think there is that's also the will to, you know, calculate it and seeing how much is it worth, what's the potential there. I mean, there's lots of interest that wanting, yes, I mean, I think many people don't want to, I mean, want to keep the whatever capitalist money-based economy. So yeah, but of course there are those from, say, the far end of the, say, sharing economy spectra that would argue just like you and say, well, why should we actually put the monetary value to these things? Couldn't it be something else? It could be another sort of coming. And so I think there is big tension here within this collaborative sort of economy.
Especially this taken over of big firms. I wonder if I don't have such a good economic background knowledge, but I'm always wondering why you let this happen at all. Why would you create such a great project and then let it be bought off by a big company? And you probably know, like, a bit like the Body Shop, which
yes.
was such a nice idea, and then you let it be bought by L'Oreal.
Mm.
And it's like, it's destroying the whole idea of it. Why do you think this... Maybe someone can explain to me why people sell their hard projects. Is it just the greed for money, really, or...?
Yeah, I mean, that's... Do you have any answers?
I don't have an answer. I have
yeah.
another question.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
the ones
that,
I'm sorry.
I don't want to cut this.
Yeah. Yeah, but maybe I think there's something in there. Even the ones that start small and, like you say, they're a project that they sort of burn for, and then maybe you get a few investors. This is, I think, what happens. I heard some of these stories. You get 3-4 people investing in your little project, and that's still very small and idealistic, and then some of them start to push you to maybe sell. You get some kind of offer, this grows, and then after a while, and then suddenly you have a house and you need to pay the whatever loans. And then I think, I mean, that happens quite. This is also what this East Wind, for instance, that also started very small scale, like a fun project. And now they're being, I mean, these guys or these small entrepreneurs are being headhunted. So, I mean, venture capitalist from San Francisco area is actually looking at many of these small sort of community entrepreneurs, and then being actually support them, and then they're being sort of paid off. Mm-hmm. What did you think of?
Just the concept of commoning. In the literature, is that the same thing as commons-based peer production?
Yeah, you could say so. I mean, commons. Okay, the concept of commoning, that is you define it as living. It's the verb of the commons, so it's living through, of, and by the commons, basically, which would be commons-based. Peer production would be the production side of commoning, whereas commoning is also to live off the commons, but very much connected. I mean, if you would remove the commons, if you would only say talk about peer production and peer-to-peer, then say Pirate Bay is peer-to-peer. Okay, but it's or what else is peer-to-peer, which is Uber. Some of the Uber services are peer-to-peer. Well, they're not commons-based. So when you add the commons-based, it means that the peer-to-peer production is returned to a common pool, which is not privately owned. Yeah.
Another thought that came up and now the term Pirate Bay came up. Is it something, is it maybe a risk of, what do you call it? your right of ownership when you created something? Okay, then can this. This whole concept, this economy, be a problem to our concept of property rights?
Mm-hmm.
Because so far, like at least with Pirate Bay, it is like this: are we claiming things to be ours, which are not, cannot be ours, or which we have to account to someone else who should be able to get paid for it?
Oh,
do you think this is an issue?
Mm-hmm. In some instances, I think, I mean, with Pirate Bay, it's clearly you create a common pool of something, but that something, those resources, are actually often then subject to private property or some kind of intellectual property rights or so. whilst that say the Kladoteket, the clothing library, that's also a common pool resources, but not doesn't I mean doesn't there's no threat to other people's private property necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there are if you would imagine, I mean, some people that I've interviewed that are into these sharing practices, they foresee or would like to work for a society where you don't even have a private property. Private property wouldn't exist.
Mm-hmm. But I especially wanted to refer to these rights, how do you call them, when you created a poem.
Oh, yeah, that's like intellectual property rights.
Exactly, intellectual property rights.
Yeah.
So, so can this idea be held up in a growing sharing economy?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think what you can see in many of these examples in the sharing economy is that you use something like the Creative Commons license, for instance,
mm-hmm.
which is... it's a way, some of you probably know it, but it's a way to, in a sense, protect an idea or a concept from being commodified or being just taken or stolen by others. But it's not the Creative Commons license. It's not you. I mean, basically the idea is, if I create an artwork, and I say it's Creative Commons, I file it under a Creative Commons license, other people can use it, build on it, and kind of alter it or so on, as long as they state the source. And as long as they don't do it for commercial purposes. You don't use my painting to
mm-hmm.
sell clothes, for instance.
Yeah.
So that's a way of, I think, protecting the whatever individual creativity amongst people and in groups. But seeing too that it's not commodified. So I think for this whole sharing economy or the commons-based peer production to work, it's very important to have some form of licensing and protection of ideas, but not necessarily in the form of the traditional intellectual property rights, where you're supposed to pay to others for usage.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, I think, an interesting, I mean, very interesting question, because very much, I mean, the modern economy is built on protection of ownership. So how would we think about, what would the society without that form of private ownership actually, what would that mean?
Ask the philosopher here about the the implications
about the Creative Commons license.
No, about like a society without property and what property does to society.
I'm not sure what other philosopher might say, but I was really interested about your question, because I think that intellectual property rights works quite different than property itself, like material property, land property. And I think in this Creative Commons license, because they are kind of license, what is most important is, yeah, of course you are sharing the thing that you made, right? But there's one condition always, I think, kept in this license. It's your name. You can share it. Yeah, you can take my work, but you have to always remember that I made it. It's always some kind of ownership,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
So keep my name with this, the thing that I create.
Mm-hmm.
So it is ownership, but of course it's quite different than in a traditional way when you have a book or you sell it, right?
Mm-hmm.
You share that book, but in this sharing, it's very important to keep my name.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what about property would philosophers might say.
Well, I was just kind of thinking of Rousseau maybe, and how he said that property was the basic of all evil, you know. When we started to have property, then everyone said...
Oh, no, when you when you read the Hobbes, for example, and you read read about the state of the nature before everything happens, starts, the laws start before it. It wasn't really fun to live in the state of the nature because it was war, everyone with everyone else. So it's so having rights, having rules, that's what makes us, living better. Mm-hmm. That's what I would hope so. But the other philosopher might say something else, right?
But I think what if we talk about a commons based society, for instance, or peer to peer society, that wouldn't mean that you don't have rules or contracts.
You said about the base of everything. This common collaborating consumption is the trust.
Mm.
But you build trust, in this community.
Mm.
But is this really something that is going on, without the nation, the country that sometimes can really help? I don't know how to say it.
But I think I understand what you mean. You need some kind of institutions or frameworks to see to how do you enable that or guarantee that trust.
Yeah, I think the trust is the problem here, the main problem.
Yeah, and because I think to me this is you probably come across Eleanor Ostrom, maybe in this course or another. I mean, what she's arguing is you have the. Okay, a little bit simplified, but you have private property and you have state or some kind of state control of resources. I mean, she's been working in the field of natural resources, and then you have some form of common property, and this is, of course, has been her focus, but that. Like you said, it's not wild nature or anarchy. I mean, she's arguing that for commons, common resources to be managed sustainably, there's quite a lot of principles that need to be there for it to function. And that is clear rules and regulations of who can use the resources, how much. What happens if somebody violates the rules, for instance, some kind of simple conflict resolution mechanisms, etc. I mean, she has this, I think, is it 6 or 8 or 10 institutional design principles. And what I think is she developed that from her empirical studies of what is it, 3,000 cases around the world, very much of fish, of land management, etc. But it hasn't, what would be interesting to do is actually to try to understand what we're seeing now with this not necessarily natural resources, but these examples in the sharing economy. What kind of principles, what kind of...
Who should lay those principles and rights?
Sorry?
Who should make?
Yeah, I mean, what she's arguing is also that in order for a common pool resource to be managed, it also needs to be specific local rules, and they need to be set by the people using the resource. Okay, so there's no standard recipe for it, but they need to have some kind of local attachment. Whatever. Yeah.
I have a question with regard to the trust replacing the money form, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
So, because one of the advantages of money is that it's anonymous, so you don't know who's the other side that you're trading with.
Yeah.
Which is also a disadvantage, but how do you deal with discrimination, things like that?
That's, I think it's really interesting question, because the idea with money is that it simplifies things rather than trading a cow against whatever sheep or something, you translate it to money. So, and then anybody's money is as good as somebody else's. But at the same time, what has happened with money is that you focus so much on money that you forget what sometimes actually what focus on the needs. So the money and the middleman takes over, sort of. And then the ones with lots of money can access much more resources than others. So there's, of course, an inequity in that. So whilst in the sharing economy, the parts of the sharing economy where trust would be the new money, so to say, you'd also have discrimination. Certain, whatever, those that are very, maybe not socially skilled, or like sick or not able to interact in a whatever reliable way, would maybe have difficulty in getting hold of the resources. So I think it doesn't solve all problems for sure, but at the same time it's maybe important to remember that also in the money you have inequality and discrimination in a sense. But yeah, for sure, I think that's one of the big problems also. For many of these examples that I have given also, what you could see is it's young, able people that are the ones doing lots of this and being able to access resources and to making, sort of capitalize on resources that they have. They're smart and quick and have a nice profile, etc., and socially sort of interested, but
I was just thinking about how do you talk about growth in sharing economy? Of course, you don't talk about growth maybe in GDP sense.
Yeah.
That's obviously not there. But do you talk about growth and what kind of way of growth are you talking about?
Yeah. I think that's also very much attention there. I think that you have those that would see that this goes very well with a growth-based economy. And you see such examples where it's not a threat, or it's not another economy. But I think those that are on that the right side that I showed, that's another economy, not based on growth. So I think that's again different, or it can go both ways in a sense. Yeah.
Just on this issue, I think we can still have both ways. If you create a local currency, you still have like anonymous, because money in any case is trust, like fiat money is trust in the government, right?
Mm-hmm.
And trust in the fact that other people will also accept this money. If you create a local currency, you can trust the kind of like who's issuing the currency, so the community as a whole, but the money is still anonymous. So I don't think you have to choose either or there,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
If it depends at which scale you're kind of defining this kind of trust zone. It's like a national trust zone, as we have with fiat money, or just like in the case of a time bank, just within students in Uppsala, that'll be, you know, I kind of trust other students in Uppsala at this level. But I've got a very practical question, because my friends recently started the street bank, I guess it will be called, in France, and they were asking me, so they're starting this peer-to-peer sharing of goods in a neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
and they were like, should we create a local currency to go with it?
Mm-hmm.
So when people, like, you know, you can borrow my surf suit, and for maybe like one, any type of fake currency a day,
mm-hmm.
a unit,
mm-hmm.
and after with this unit I can borrow something for something else, and they were asking, you know, can we do it without a currency, or should we have a currency? Finally, they decided to go with a currency, because they thought we'd give an incentive for people to kind of like loan more, and that will be more fair. This way the people that put a lot, they are rewarded. But
yeah.
What do you think about this?
Mm-hmm. I think it has both, positive and negative things with when you attach a currency to it. I mean, like you say, it's the idea is to get some kind of reciprocity in it. And there are many such systems where you have invented some kind of currency. There is this site called Jurdle, for instance. It's become very big now in the US and Canada. And they have, so it's basically a trading of of whatever things that you have, but then you don't. It's not like you swap services, but the ones that have given a lot of things, they earn points.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's probably a bit like you're saying.
Exactly.
I mean, maybe if you do it with that, with a currency, you get the potential for larger whatever group to use it. Whereas if you do it, there are those that are more in a gift economy. Maybe it becomes smaller, but maybe you want to keep it small. I mean, I guess that depends on your ambitions. But maybe it should be. It's also important to say that if you do it with the currency, then you have a problem with the tax department in at least in Sweden. Maybe not in France. I don't know. I think in Spain it's totally fine. I know the Netherlands totally fine. You can have these time banks, and then you have a currency. You trade in some kind of hours or something. That's fine. It's legal. But if you would be interested in doing it here, and I think you are, if you do it in a more, if you do it in a friend, whatever a circle of friends, it's fine. But if you do it in a larger system with a currency, I think it's illegal. Actually, so it's good to know at least.
One contribution that I have that I thought is, it would probably solve the problem that I see when I think about borrowing things to other people is that, well, what happens if it breaks?
Yeah.
Can I trust them so much that they will refund the actual money that I had to invest in this, so that I'm fine basically, and I can buy a new product.
Yeah.
So if you had a currency which would enable you to like get something back, maybe not the same product, but at least a certain amount of other services within the system, then at least you know you have been refunded in advance, so the fear of losing out is diminished a little bit, at least.
Yeah.
I think this, there should be more mechanisms of remedying this mistrust about, it could break, and then are you really going to repair it for me or get me a new one?
Yeah. Or to get away with a free rider phenomenon.
I mean, that even happens among friends.
Yeah.
I broke it. Sorry. I'm like, yeah, no problem.
Yeah. So you had a question. Yeah.
I have one more question. With regard to this local currency thing, so I think in Austria it also wouldn't be allowed, for example, in difference to Spain, as you said.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder your opinion, how should a state deal with such developments then?
With a local currency?
For example, with sharing, so which are opportunity for prosperity, but at the same time a threat to the current welfare system.
Yes. That's a good question. I hope to be able to answer it in some time, actually. So, yeah, I think it's actually what I'm trying to find out through this project is also how should the institutions and the public react to this? Because I think there is, for sure, a potential here. And this is something we need to find forms for. I mean, the will here to create more sharing and solidarity, whatever relationships, I think it's the public institutions somehow facilitate that and find forms that, not saying it's illegal, for instance, to whatever, swap or share certain things. But at the same time, of course, you need to have a certain control of it and see to that it doesn't follow out the tax base. And also the problem now with, like I said, many of these that are becoming sort of micro entrepreneurs and doing lots of different things, maybe they have a quite small formal income, and then you have very little public insurance, or your inkomst becomes very small. So maybe you need to have a system it's a basic income, that many people argue that with this kind of sharing economy, you need another type of welfare system. It needs to be reformed to to match it in a sense. So, but I think it's difficult to say how or so. But I think what we have now, there for sure there are confrontations and things that don't work. And also many of these examples like this, each way they operate in a zone where they're not legal, they're not illegal either. So, yeah. Shall we take it? I need to soon get to bus to, but we take a final question. Okay. Yeah.
Well, it's not meant to be a final question, but somehow it touches on tax evasion as a driving force.
Tax
evasion.
Evasion. Oh, to get away from it.
Yeah.
I think what should I say? I mean, many of these, I think, small scale practices that I've shown, it's not about that so much, actually. I think there are there are actually examples of it, some of them, but the big ones are actually doing it in a planned way and with much more capital, which I think is a bigger problem, maybe. Yeah, thanks for an interesting discussion. Yeah.